Now, Property Monday continues as Margaret Lomas and her team answer all on Your Money, Your Call.
Hello and welcome once again to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas and thanks for joining me tonight. Now this week we have a great show planned where we take a look at what's happening in Adelaide and also answer your questions about depreciation. Helping me tonight, I've asked into the studio the property professor, Peter Koulizos, and Brad Beer from BMT Tax Depreciation, who are experts in those topics. So tonight is your chance to join in on the conversation, and you can contact us at any time during the show with your comments, questions, or to just get some guidance. So get to the phones and call us right now on 1330 3435. Tweet me at Margaret Lomas. Are you making sure that you hashtag YMYC, or email me right now at property@skynews.com.au. Welcome to the program tonight, and let's go straight to the latest property news. And real estate investors who buy new instead of old property can save more than $5,000 a year from tax deductions and other benefits, but are being warned to crunch all the numbers before taking the plunge. Property investment and accounting firm New Vision says new property delivers thousands of extra dollars of negative gearing and other tax incentives each year, while lower maintenance and repair costs save investors more money. Tax deductions depend on the property and the investor's tax rate, but are bigger for newer assets. Welcome to you both.
Thank you very much, Margaret.
Brad, we have this conversation here a lot, and I guess one of the things that the spruikers of new property like to push is the depreciation benefits, but it doesn't have to be brand new.
And the age of property does impact on the amount of depreciation claimed, and people get this mentality that new, it has to be new to get it, and I think they're much better than that than they used to be. But something that's 2 years old,
Your construction cost's
not much different.
Yeah.
Your carpet is slightly older, so the value's not going to be quite as much. But the actual difference in overall deductions for a 2-year-old property is actually not a heap. Now, if we're talking about a 15-year-old property, there's a bit more of a difference, but something 0 to 5 years old doesn't actually have a massive amount of difference, especially in its first few years of deductions.
Absolutely. And I guess, Peter, the thing that the viewers really need to understand is that when you're buying new or off the plan or from a developer, a project home, there's very little room for negotiation. Or if you're building it yourself, there's probably none. But if you buy that property that's already 2 years old, it's a little bit like that brand new car that you drive out of the showroom that loses all that money. You can often negotiate a significantly lower price, which is going to more than offset the less depreciation, which is a tiny amount.
That's right. Brad brings up a very good point. If it's 2 years old, you've still got 38 years worth of depreciation. So whether it's 38 or 40, but as you say, the opportunity to negotiate the purchase price at the beginning can help you a lot as the years go on.
You certainly, if you're looking for a property in an area that's quite new, and there's a lot of new properties, but there's some that have already settled, there are always people after a year or two who are ready to move out.
That's right.
And you might even find someone who has a desperate circumstance to want to move out. And you can often, it's that whole builder's premium's gone by then. It's considered used rather than new. And you can really get some good discounts.
Builder's premium and developer's profit can add a lot to that bottom line, and for you that's just really wasted money. That's not adding any value.
Look, I think a fundamental question or thing about buying new or buying secondhand, or, you know, some of this article we're talking about here is talking about tax deductions and the focus on buying for tax deductions. And look, I'm the depreciation guy and I create those deductions, but I would say they're really a bonus and something that applies to all properties, and they're a cash flow thing. The overall decision on buying something that has the right drivers for growth should drive what you buy more than the tax deductions associated with it.
Exactly. The other thing, of course, that a lot of people don't realise is that there are a lot of areas where properties were initially sold either off the plan or out as part of a new subdivision, but because it was such a new subdivision, the real market value was set by that developer and not ever really established. Mm. And then once those properties get into the secondary market, a real market value is established. And I've seen a lot of areas. Redbank Plains is a perfect example where a new subdivision was massive. The properties were selling well over the $400,000 mark, and this is quite some time ago. And once we started to get into resales on or about the two-year mark, they were reselling at $290,000 and $300,000.
Yeah,
and investors were swooping in and taking advantage of that. But those first buyers were really, really ripped off.
And I think it's always good if you're looking at a new area like that, a really important thing is to compare it to what other three-bedroom, you know, slightly older property is selling for in that market. Because if it's highly different, eventually that one's going to be secondhand. It's not quite as shiny, and it'll come back to some sort of equilibrium value to the others, unless they're going to come up to that. But unless there's enough difference in the stock and the product, and even if there is enough difference, fundamentally, something next door that is heaps cheaper is going to start looking attractive unless there's a reason to drag it up.
Absolutely. Well, look, let's go to the email. And with Peter here tonight, it's a good chance to answer this question that also comes from a Peter. And he asks, I'm looking to invest in a residential property. I was at a seminar where they suggested Adelaide is a good opportunity right now because of the $39 billion shipbuilding and the new $2.1 billion Royal Adelaide Hospital. Now, I'm from Melbourne and I have very little knowledge of Adelaide. However, I have been researching Semaphore, which is near the shipbuilding facilities, but there appears to be too many houses for sale in that area. What are your thoughts? Now, Peter, before we talk about specifically Semaphore, mm-hmm. and before we really talk about Adelaide too, I think people just have to first of all be careful about what that seminar presented.
That's what I was going to start with. Yes, that's right.
Area.
Yeah, because they might be doing deals with developers, and it's come along to this seminar, and by the way, we've got something brand new for you to buy in Adelaide.
Yeah.
So that was the first thing I was going to mention. Very good there, Margaret. Very good pickup.
Yes, of course.
But look, Adelaide is the BP of the nation, the quiet achiever. I've seen that its property price has been doing quite well compared to the rest of the country. And we've got a lot of things going on. I know most people don't really care about Adelaide when it comes to property and many other things, but we've got the new hospital, which will be finished next year. Right next door to that is the University of Adelaide Medical School, which will be completed very soon. Right next door to that is the University of South Australia Health and Innovation Building, which will be completed next year. Submarines come on in the year 2018. There are some major, major road infrastructure projects happening at the moment, and Peter has hit the nail on the head, I think. So far as the submarines are concerned, Semaphore is a prime suburb in that location. Semaphore is very similar to St Kilda in Melbourne.
Yep.
A lot of character homes, a lot of activity in the main road, which is Semaphore Road. And he says that there seems to be a lot of properties for sale, but there's three Semaphores. There's Semaphore, Semaphore Park and Semaphore South. So that might be a little bit confusing, but I think Semaphore is a great spot. Largs Bay, Largs North.
The whole thing's a peninsula.
It is, the Lefevre Peninsula.
And the best thing about a peninsula, I always believe, is that when it's sort of all full, it's full.
Mm.
And then we get a real land supply issue. And now the road that goes straight up sort of the middle a little bit to the desalination plant side is Commercial Road or mm-hmm. some name like that, just that main road.
Yeah.
And presently anything on the...
Oh, Victoria Road.
Victoria Road.
Yes, Victoria Road.
That was going to be my...
Don't buy east side of Victoria
Road. Okay, you say that. You say that. However, my experience with that sort of thing is very often that if you get just over, just in the east, that very often once the properties on the other side become too expensive, they're dragged up faster on the other side. Just obviously don't get a property with a view of the desalination plant. Mm-hmm. But if you're only just on the other side, you've had success with that, haven't you, Brad, where you bought properties that were just sort of on the verge of somewhere else that was even better?
Look, definitely I've bought properties that have been probably in the slightly lower socioeconomic area but close to areas that were quite a bit more expensive and performed very, very well because there's still It's a bit like our Redbank planes example. Is there enough to help get that dragged up? And if there's enough to maintain some prices in the nicer area, which is what you're looking at here, mm-hmm. and you're on a peninsula, there's not more land, the water's still across the way, and the more expensive house is there. And across the road, if this goes up substantially, the gap widens and at a at a percentage growth of what you've maybe bought into this one over here means that, okay, well, I can't afford 600, but what was 200 turns to 300, 300 becomes looking attractive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And the other thing is, in this particular peninsula, if you're just on the east side of Victoria Road, you're still only 10 streets from the beach.
You are. Yeah, look,
like,
you're
it's
not, that
not
far
a very
from,
wide peninsula.
The problem is that section is not just light industrial, there's heavy industrial and chemical.
True.
So you don't want to get too close to that section. But I understand the logic.
Yeah.
Just a little bit over the other side of the road.
Lots cheaper.
Yep.
The whole peninsula is probably 16 roads wide. I think I counted it once. Yeah. It's like not very wide and probably, you know, 30 long. So you can get some good property. And that, you know, that principle does apply everywhere, I think.
Mm, I've that ripple effect.
Yeah. I've seen it happen in so many places.
Well, the ones that I've purchased over time that haven't necessarily done as well, sorry, that have done well in that are in cheaper areas weren't, it wasn't that there was a water and necessarily the amount of land constraint, but enough land constraint and proximity to areas that people wanted to be, that it still worked okay and it's been good.
Well, who'd have thought that Mayfield would suddenly become the little trendy centre of Newcastle, which it has become?
I got a valuation on a place there recently and I had to, like, look twice. And someone I knew was trying to buy properties and they're looking at properties. I'm like, surely you can't. Surely they're not going for that much there. I guess my valuation showed that that is the case, which is great. But it did used to definitely, when I first went to uni in Newcastle many years ago now, Mayfield was like, it was a place not to go, and you got stuff all over your clothes.
Yeah. A place where you didn't admit that you were from.
And it definitely, the pricing, you know, the massive amount of change, it's definitely one of those ugly ducks that's gone ridiculous.
Absolutely. Well, it is good to have you on board for the show tonight. If you have a question or a comment and you also want to be in the running to win a copy of one of my books, then get to the phones, the email, or even to Twitter with your question. At the end of the show, every tweet, email, and caller whose questions we use on the show scores a copy of my book, How to Achieve Property Success. Now, this is a great book about the entire property investing process, equally good for new and experienced investors. Call us on 1300 30 34 35. Tweet me at Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC or email property at skynews.com.au with a question. And if we answer it tonight, make sure that you watch the end of the show to see how to get your copy. It is time for us to take a very short break. Don't go away. When we come back, we'll continue the discussion and get on with as many of your questions as we can. We'll be right back soon with more. Always a pleasure to have your company on the show tonight. The property professor, Peter Koulizos, and Brad Beer from BMT Tax Depreciation are standing by to take your calls. So don't waste any time. Call us now on 1300 30 34 35. Tweet me on Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC or email us on property at skynews.com.au. Kevin from Sydney, welcome to the program. How are you doing?
Yes, good evening, Margaret. Good evening, panel. Look, my question is in relation to units on the Gold Coast, particularly between Burleigh Heads and Broadbeach. I'm thinking of buying one for retirement purposes, and I've made inquiries recently. And if I could preface my remarks by saying I found them a little bit evasive when it came to completion dates in both cases. And I just wondered, Margaret, first of all, does Queensland have the same protection that's been being introduced in New South Wales as far as the sunset clause is concerned? And secondly, a respected valuer, Heron Todd White, have likened the Gold Coast market to be at a peak. And with the oversupply, which is very evident from your program in Brisbane, is the same going to happen with all these new developments on the Gold Coast?
Mm.
I'd like your
Sure. Look, I think with regard to oversupply of units in the Gold Coast, that horse has well and truly bolted, and we're well into oversupply and have been for years. You know, the Gold Coast market, some people are calling the bottom. I'm not sure we're at the bottom yet, but there's certainly so much oversupply of units and so many people who bought them for retirement purposes and have now found that they need to divest themselves of them, that I think in addition to all the new developments, there's going to be years and years supply of existing properties. What's your opinion,
Peter? Well, Kevin, I'm not a very big fan of new property. I know we've got some, you know, you can get some great depreciation, but the problem with new apartments on the Gold Coast, we are talking about a market that's already oversupplied, as Margaret has already mentioned. So I'd be very careful. Plus, the other thing is, if you're retiring and you're on a fixed income, you want to watch out for the body corporate fees, because that's a constant drain on your cash flow, whether you're living in it or not. So you need to get some information from the agents about what the body corporate fees will be. So, for example, if you've got a swimming pool, spa, sauna, gym, everyone needs to chip in to maintain that, as well as the lifts and so on. So just be very wary about buying brand new or off the plan apartments on the Gold Coast.
In New South Wales, we have the new legislation which gives fairly strict sunset clauses around completion dates. Are you aware of anything like that that exists in Queensland?
No, not aware of the same being there in Queensland, but I think sometimes the evasiveness around completion, especially in the market at the moment, where developers, if they haven't started construction, they'll need a certain amount of sales off the plan before, Kevin, they can actually start construction. The financier will require that. So until they get those, the ability to secure the finance to build the project actually might be a little bit tough. And therefore, telling you when it's going to finish, when they can't guarantee when it's going to start, can actually be a little bit difficult. And the banks have actually got a little bit harsher on financing based on, I guess, oversupply of property that they see in general, and probably more their thoughts are around that Brisbane CBD market or Melbourne CBD market. And I think, you know, that the Gold Coast has probably had some of this issue for a little bit longer. Is it at the bottom, and has it got a potential to change? Probably sooner than some of those other areas would be my thoughts. But around that evasion and completion, I suppose that's probably part of the question there. I also think this is a different question than just investing, because you're talking about where you actually want to retire. And that's probably number one question to answer. Retiring means you're going to live there. So it's like you're really thinking about, what am I buying as my house in the end? Providing, I mean, you might have some criteria on a certain area, but then maybe that new development that looks as shiny might not be the perfect one. But if it doesn't return in value in a really quick sense, and you love it and you want to live there, then I don't have so much of a problem with it.
No, that's right. If it's just for lifestyle rather than investment,
yeah.
Different story.
Look, Kevin, there's plenty of attraction for retiring on the Gold Coast, and I must admit I was there again the other day and thinking to myself that I can really see how the Gold Coast, there's a huge part of the Gold Coast which is really centred around providing lifestyle benefits to people who are in retirement. There's a significant portion of the Gold Coast that are in retirement, and it has an older average age in the Gold Coast than the national average. So I think it's, you know, in the late 40s, the average age in the Gold Coast. There's certainly two parts of the Gold Coast. There's a significant portion of it which is young families, and a significant portion that is the retired. What I'd be inclined to do if I were you, it sounds to me like you're looking at this property from a developer. It sounds to me like there's a third party, a middleman, a marketer, someone selling it to you. He's told you a few things. I think I'd be very careful about really scouring the resale market and making sure that you can't pick up someone else's misfortune, which will give you the same kind of apartment, the same kind of benefits at a much cheaper price than you would buy off the plan. And I would be inclined to do that. Even if you were to buy it now and then rent it out until you're ready for it, and get some rental benefits from that while you're still working, I'd be inclined to do that. I think you will pick up an existing apartment a lot cheaper than you can get anything off the plan at the moment. If you do want to go ahead with the off the plan, don't do so thinking it is going to be a good investment for you, because that market is still very iffy for me, and I just don't know when it's going to hit the bottom, and I don't know when it's going to turn around. There's too much supply on the horizon and too much existing supply without enough demand to see a big change in the next 5 to 6 years. If you do go ahead with the off the plan, though, you can write your own sunset clause into the contract. Don't forget, you can write anything you want into any contract, and it's then up to the person selling you the property, in this case the developer, to accept or reject that clause. So I'd be very careful about getting very specific advice from a lawyer about what kind of sunset clauses you want written into that contract, and don't go ahead with the contract unless you get the clauses that you want in it. And that can even be clauses that allows you to make some changes to your apartment as well. Many developers will allow that. Changes that suit you and your lifestyle that may not be in the standard apartments that are being sold. We have an email now from Hayden, and Hayden asks, I'm currently researching what considerations are to be made when demolishing an investment property. If a depreciation schedule is in place for the property, are you able to claim the residual value of all depreciable assets, the building structure and the plant? Is this an immediate claimable amount, or is it a capital loss which offsets any gain in that year, future years? It's a good question, Brad, because I know we often talk about scrapping, and we talk about how if you're renovating, what about if you're just ripping down a whole building?
Very similar. Same thing really applies. You're knocking over whatever value is left. So if you were renting this property out properly before this, as per normal, just like you throw away a stove, if you throw away a whole house, which you normally don't do on new houses often.
I've just thrown four houses away, so I'm happy to hear all of this.
So it's really quite simple. Whatever, if you've got a depreciation schedule in place, then everything's had some sort of value put on it at some point, and it'll be at your purchase or when it was constructed or when renovations have been done to that property. And then you'll have claimed some value on those items, and there will be a residual value that's left. In the year you knock that over, instantly deductible in that year.
And I guess really important to point out here that if the building is really, really old, it's not going to be that much that you really are writing off in that year.
The report should be able to spill out what the actual residual value is that you would normally keep claiming. Now, if it was new, quick, otherwise, you know, there might be just some of the value of the kitchens and renovations left and planned.
And Hayden, if it is a very, very old building, you might not have anything on the actual construction to claim anyway, or there could have been some improvements done that you can claim on, but certainly speak to an accountant and a quantity surveyor. It's time for us to pop off for just a quick break, but we'll be back soon. Now, if you have a question for us, call us to join the queue on 1330 3435. Tweet me to Margaret Lomas, AU, with the hashtag YMYC, or email property@skynews.com.au. You never know, you could win the question of the week. We'll be right back. Thanks for tuning in tonight for our property edition of Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas from Destiny Financial Solutions, and tonight the property professor, Peter Koulizos, and Brad Beer from BMT Tax Depreciation are here and ready to take your call. So call us now on 1300 30 34 35, tweet Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or you can email us on property@skynews.com.au. We're going to go to the phones, and Kate from Sydney. How are you doing, Kate?
Good, thanks, Margaret. Hello, and hello, panel. I'm so happy you're talking about South Australia tonight. I've got a couple of properties there, wonderful buy-in prices and excellent yield. And I'm thinking of Christie's Beach for the next one. I do have property in another state as well, so I'm diversifying, but I am impressed with South Australia. Mm. What do you think of Christie's Beach, or do you think it's already done its dash?
Well, I just bought a property in Christie's Beach myself, Kate, about a month ago.
I picked up a little cracker
on a corner block.
Did you?
Yeah, that I'm able to develop into four.
Remember the street?
No, I do not. Okay. I don't know how I'm supposed to know the streets.
Well, I bought one on a corner last year, and I'm developing it as we speak in Christie's Beach.
Do you remember the street?
Shepherd Road. Yes, I do. And last week I bought one in Port Nolunga, which is right next door to Christie's
Beach.
Yeah, nice. One that can be developed.
So give us your thoughts. Obviously,
Kate's a very smart lady. Kate's a very smart lady. Christie's Beach, Kate, is an area that nobody really talked about years ago. It was too far away from Adelaide. It was a bit down and out.
Which is hilarious. It's like 20, 25 minutes away.
Yeah, that's right. For Sydney people, it's probably really close to town.
It's hilarious.
Yeah. But now we've got a lot of infrastructure which has brought it closer to the city. We've got the Southern Expressway. The train line that has actually been extended past Christie's Beach, Dyson Road. So it's actually come closer to the city. The local council is very good in upgrading its infrastructure. State government has also helped. And now the private sector has come in. I mean, small scale. Margaret's talking about developing her site, I'm developing mine. But you've also got some other big-time developers coming in doing some great stuff on Beach Road or next door at the Port Nolunga Village. So, Kate, I think if you've got your eye on Christie's Beach, you are certainly looking in the right spot.
Ackland Avenue.
Ackland Avenue. Yes, I know Ackland Avenue. Very good. I think I know the property too.
Oh, do you?
That's a very good buy.
It's a deceased estate.
That's a very good buy, mate.
I know it is, isn't it?
Yeah, mine was a deceased estate too last week.
Yeah, a lot of people dying down there in Christie's Beach, but don't let that put you off, Kate. Still a great place to buy. Look, Kate, I think it's still a good place to buy. This is what I always say about South Australia and areas down in the south. You're probably not going to get any Sydney-style sudden, amazing, massive boom, although it's not beyond reason that you could. They certainly did over in Perth, and the boom in Perth happened before the resources boom, so it wasn't because of the resources boom that it happened. So it could happen. But what you do get down in South Australia, as you probably already know since you own a few properties there, is every year they go up a little bit. And it's a really nice, safe area to be buying because you're getting that little bit of growth every year, year in, year out. It's like inflation. It just goes up year in, year out, and you're always sure that next year your property is going to be worth a little bit more than it was last year. And that's what I like so much about it. Well, Kevin's question is about a poor property investment, and he asks, I bought a block of land in Laguna Keys, Turtle Point Golf Course in Queensland in 2007 for $285,000. The resort went into receivership in 2009, and my land is currently worth $70,000 to $80,000 based on market value. I paid this down as much as I can, and I only have $70,000 owing on the loan. Rates are approximately $1,700 a year and body corporate $1,500. There has been a lot of talk about a Chinese company investing money into the region, but I'm wondering if I should sell and get into something else. I'm not sure what to do. Golf course estates, Brad.
Look, what a horror story.
Golf course estates, they have razzle and dazzle and fabulous salespeople around them, and they sell the dream, but typically golf course estates don't do well.
And I think, that golf course, the concept of living on the golf course and being oversold at that early stage is something that, unless you're also close to other things in life that you need, that it doesn't... You can't play golf every day, or I don't think everyone can. I couldn't fish every day forever.
I don't like fishing, golf every day.
but it's not the norm that you don't get sick of golf every day, I think. Yeah. Whether it's a golf course estate or, I mean, this is a terrible horror story of being sold something that has really gone bad. I guess on the question of the future, what does the $70,000 that you still owe stop you from investing in? Does it mean that you can't buy something that makes some money or you're burnt forever? Does it mean that your cash flow is held up by what debt you still have to pay on that and the expenses associated with that? I wouldn't hang my hat on someone's maybe coming to invest in the area for the future and hope for growth based on that. I don't know the area well enough to probably comment on that, but sometimes in life you've just got to cut your losses and run.
Peter, so one of the things that the viewers probably aren't thinking through, which I certainly am, because I've been in a position before where I bought a block of land that has lost a significant amount of value, nowhere near as bad as this. For me, it was $60,000 that it lost. But the other thing that the viewers might not realise is that because it's a block of land and he had a debt on it, He's lost some $200,000 in the value, but it's probably cost him about $15,000 a year in interest on the loan since 2007. So we're talking 9 years at 15 grand a year in loan interest. We probably got another $130,000 on top of that, which is compounding the loss.
Yeah. But we're not here to give financial advice, are we, Margaret? But look, you're in a very difficult position. As Brad's already said, you're going to think of the opportunity cost. What is that $70,000 stopping you from doing? I mean, if you have other capital gains in the future, you might be able to offset against that. But it's a very difficult situation, but a lesson to be learnt in that, like you said, golf course estates don't tend to do very well.
No, they certainly don't. Brad, you've got that little...
I remember seeing him at property expos back in the day, Margaret.
Oh, yes.
Remember Cypress Lakes up in the Hunter Valley. Now, that still, I don't know, has returned to what it was when they first sold that, and that's a long time now.
Look, Tallwoods is probably another example that probably did okay. I'm from up around that area.
But even then, it hasn't done that well. It's really...
Okay at the start, but then it had a long period of flat, and the golf course ends up not looked after even, so you can't go even...
We have one down south in Adelaide called Wirrina, which was developed back in the 90s, and apartments there are selling for the same price today as they were back in the 90s,
so
25 years ago.
So none of this helps you at all, I'm afraid, Kevin. I guess what the boys are trying to say to you is if holding it stops you from adding to the portfolio elsewhere, it could be time to sell. I'm a big fan of saying, well, you know, if it's not holding you back, keep it. In this case, though, I'm not so sure because I can't see that there's going to be any good outcome ever for it. I don't know that having the Chinese come into the area is going to make any change to this golf course estate, I'm sorry, because it's not just about this estate and what is and isn't there. It's about all golf course estates. They all typically do very badly. People buy them initially because it all seems really good, but then nobody can sell them from there. They sell just enough to get those first sales gone. You also have to think about the fact that you're servicing the $70,000 with more interest, and you're also servicing those body corporate fees and your land rates. And when you add all of that up, it's a very big loss. Now, what you can do when you sell is your buy-in price can be adjusted with a lot of those costs, your capitalised interest, a whole lot of things, to make the loss bigger than what it really is even. So there's a lot of those things that you can claim. And then when you do make a big amount of money after reading my book tonight that you're getting, and when you start to invest in really good assets, then in the future if you sell one of those, that loss can carry forward forever to offset against a future capital gain. So it doesn't feel great, but that is a benefit that you do get. Ben from Melbourne, how are you doing, Ben?
Good, thanks. Thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome. What can we do for you?
First of all, I'd like to thank you for your advice earlier on in the year to me. I was having really big problems with my real estate agent that was managing my property. The tenants trashed the property and so forth. I took your advice. All your advice of how to find another real estate agent. Now I've got fantastic tenants in the property.
That's great.
So I've got a very different, maybe a unique question for you.
Okay.
Is, because they're such good tenants, they're great tenants, what sort of Christmas present should I send them? I'm going to send them a Christmas present with a card.
Yep.
I was thinking of a bottle of wine, but I'm afraid they might trash the house if they get drunk. So I was wondering what sort of any ideas of any sort of Christmas present I can give them. I can be, you know, like a Santa landlord this year and see how it goes for the first time.
Well, that's very nice of you, and I've got an idea. What do you think?
Two things. Either movie tickets, and if they're really good tenants, maybe gold class, or like a Meijer voucher or something like that, that they can spend on whatever they choose to. Because you're assuming they drink. They may not drink. Or they may not like red wine and you buy them red wine.
I was actually thinking movie tickets is probably a good idea. I'd probably, and because you do have the issue with wine being potentially they don't like it, but I'm sure with one bottle between them, they probably won't trash your house.
Well, I'm probably a bit more generous than these two misers sitting here with me, and I was going to suggest, how about a week's free rent?
Oh,
I mean, they think all their Christmases have come at once, and to you, it isn't going to cost you as much as that full week's rent, because remember, all the tax deductions that you get off not getting it, you know, that it depends on how much rent they're paying for you, to you. But imagine that, if you got told that week over Christmas there's no rent to pay, how excited would that tenant be? They're going to stick with you forever.
Look, I think it's less expensive than having to release the property as well, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Mm, very true.
I wouldn't give mine anything, but then I'm not as nice as you. The gift that I give my tenants is that they're allowed to rent the property. So, yeah, look, I'm being facetious now. Of course, if I had fabulously wonderful tenants, I would like to make a gesture like that, and there's a couple of ideas for you. Hopefully one of them is one that you like. But now we have an email from Anna, and Anna says, I'm looking at purchasing a live-in property. As I want to keep below $200,000 in total, I'm looking at purchasing high-end land on the Fluro Peninsula in South Australia and living in a fitted-out shipping container. The other option is to purchase in the mid-north where land is cheaper and build a new home where I can get the $15,000 grant. What would be the best option for investment and resale given the different areas and home dwelling type? We must point out here that if she's talking about investment and live-in, two entirely different animals, and my first gut feeling when I read this was the two things that she plans to do for her live-in property, the shipping container or buying in the far north cheap land, neither of them would actually make a good investment.
And it does come down, we need to start back at the first thing about, do you want to live in a shipping container, I suppose, to start with? Now, in saying that, a lot of shipping containers these days are actually fit out properly, and they're kind of like a little house, so that shouldn't be necessarily a problem. I think that where you want to live and what you want to live in is a better question to ask. If you've got to keep under $200,000, you've got these rules. I think the concept of rent vesting and you know, renting where you want to live and investing in areas that you think really will make money, that have the fundamental drivers to drive value growth and cash flow, that means that maybe $200,000 doesn't have to be the number, is probably a first thing I'd consider.
So thinking about, instead of buying into something that's really, really cheap, if you are looking for growth, getting in, continuing to rent. And in those areas that you want to rent in, the rent's probably quite cheap.
Mm.
It is in the Fluro Peninsula.
I doubt the Victor Harbour Council would let you live in a shipping container or any other council down there. And the problem with building up in the mid-north is finding a builder. And if you do, they'll probably charge you more for building the house than if it was in Adelaide. So maybe, like Margaret said before, rather than looking for brand new, maybe look for one that's relatively new and you don't have to have all those hassles about building or finding a builder. That might be a better option. And mid-north is much cheaper than down south on the Fluro Peninsula.
Look, the problem that I have for you at the moment is the amount of money you're talking about spending, which is under $200,000, can only buy you in an area that probably has quite a small population, quite a low jobs rate, and very little going for it in terms of the capacity to grow. Now, remember, if you are looking to get growth out of a property, you've got to be able to buy in the areas with growth drivers, and at the moment there's really no area that I can think of in the whole country under $200,000 that will give you that kind of growth that you need. But nor do you need to get a lot of good growth if you are going to be living in it yourself. And remember that any growth that you do get in an owner-occupied property, all of that growth you own, none of it has to go to capital gains tax. So the reliance on growth is a little less, unless you want this property to grow well enough so you can use it to leverage into more investment property, in which case I'm with Brad. I would continue to rent somewhere and I would use all of my borrowing capacity to buy a property to rent out to someone else and make sure that I got it in a really good growth area, which, again, you'll be able to identify because you're going to get a copy of one of my books. Well, thanks for tuning in. We have to take a short break for a few messages, but please stay tuned. When we come back, you'll have another chance to get hold of a copy of my book, How to Achieve Property Success. But you will have to ask a question and have it answered tonight. Simply call now on 1300 30 34 35, tweet Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or you can also email us on property@skynews.com.au. Be right back here soon with more. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas from Destiny, and it's been my pleasure tonight to host the property professor, Peter Koulizos, and Brad Beer from BMT Tax Depreciation. Our lines are closed for tonight as we'll be finishing up the show at 9 p.m. to make way for a new episode in the summer series of Property Success. But we do have time for these last questions. First of all, Matthew, you're on the line. Matthew?
Yeah, hi, Margaret. Thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome.
Look, my question's a little bit about land tax. I currently own three properties in southeast Queensland, and I'm looking at going for a fourth one next year. It doesn't have to be in southeast Queensland, and I would like to diversify. But is land tax a consideration you take into account?
Are your properties all house and land?
All house and land, all between $400,000 and $500,000.
Okay.
And if you think we should diversify, where's the hot spot for that sort of price range?
Okay, all right. Okay, now bearing in mind, Peter, that unlike South Australia, in Queensland it's land value only that land tax is levied on. And I think it's a reasonably high threshold in Queensland. Off the top of my head, it's like $600,000, I think, so it's quite a high threshold. However, with three, he's going to be getting very close to that already.
Certainly land tax is a consideration, but a bit like Brad said at the beginning, there are more important things to consider, like where are the capital growth drivers? And if that means you have to buy another one in southeast Queensland and your land tax increases, that just may be a cost of doing business. So don't give up the great capital growth just because you've got to pay an extra few hundred dollars in land tax. Because there are other ways to minimise that. You can put it in your partner's name, maybe put it in a different entity. But I think the big focus should be on the capital growth drivers. Where are you going to make that big profit?
Mm. And I pay a fair bit of land tax, especially in New South Wales.
But it can hurt. It can be.
Oh, yes.
I do see it as a cost of doing business, but one that's kind of annoying and continues. And the other thing is it actually keeps going up as your land values go up.
Mm. And it can be avoided.
Yes. Now, but in New South Wales, it's tough because you get your threshold, you only get yourself and your partner a threshold, where in Queensland, from what I understand, in a new entity, you can actually start a new threshold. So, but then you have to have a new entity. You don't want to start new entities for the purpose of just that tax reason either.
Mm. Because starting the new entity can be very costly, even more than the land tax that you save.
Exactly. So some advice from a tax perspective around that. But then looking at other areas, and land tax is one thing, but I'm back to the same thing from the start. It shouldn't be the driving question behind where or what you buy. It should be the things that have the drivers for growth to make money out of property in the future.
Look, Matthew, from my perspective, it's more than the land tax here. You've already got three in southeast Queensland. I think you have enough in southeast Queensland. Much as I like the area, if it doesn't perform the way we all expect, all your eggs are in that basket. There's so many great places in Melbourne at the moment that everyone's missing. And I remember only about 2 years ago telling everyone what they were missing in Brisbane and telling everyone what they were missing in Sydney. And, you know, I've been pretty close to right in a lot of those occasions. Some great places in southeast Melbourne that you can buy into for a similar price that I think have a far better prognosis for you at the moment, or similar prognosis, but allows you to do that diversification, and then you don't have to worry about the land tax at all. I'd much rather see you diversify on this occasion, and then you're taking care of your two problems, the diversification problem and all of your eggs in the one basket, and the land tax problem, which you're not going to like if the Queensland government turns around and decides to hike land tax, reduce the threshold, or do any one of a number of other things that governments tend to do when they know they can make a fair amount of money out of something. Well, it is now time for us to take a look at the brand new episode of Property Success for this week. And so it's time to say goodbye to my guests tonight, Brad Beer and Peter Koulizos, who will both be back in 2017 with more great property investing advice. And next week is our last Your Money, Your Call show for 2016. And joining me then will be Tony Hayek and Ben Kingsley. You can get your questions to me through the week at property@skynews.com.au or via my Twitter account. Thanks also to our callers. If we answered your question on the show via email, tweet or your call, email me now on yourmoneyyourcall@destiny.com.au, which you can see there on the bottom of your screen, yourmoneyyourcall@destiny.com.au. Tell me which question you asked and provide me with your mailing address and I will send you your book. You can contact me between shows on Twitter at Margaret Lomas AU, Instagram at Margaret Lomas Property, or via my website destiny.com.au, where you can also get some great educational content, podcasts and video blogs, all free of charge and fabulous if you're looking to build a property portfolio. Now, if you missed any of the show, you want to listen again or catch up on any of the program, go to your favourite podcast platform and search for Sky News, Your Money, Your Call. Don't go away, though. After the break, I'm back with episode 2 in my summer series of Property Success. It's a great educational half hour. And this week, I'm bringing you some of my highlights from season 8. Kevin Turner has a great new segment for us, and I'm up in Queensland looking at Richlands, Inala and Forest Lake, to find out how they stack up for investment. I'll be back with more Your Money, Your Call next week. Until then, happy investing.
The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.